Okay, I'm gonna call this meeting to order at 6:04 on September 13th, and I'm gonna turn it over to our new superintendent, who I guess I will reintroduce, Dr. Lynn Carey. I've seen her so many times that it seems like you've been here for a while, so I'll turn it over to her for reorganization.
I'd like to move Cynthia Womet for another term as the chairman.
Requesting nominations?
Bob?
Thank you, and Bill, second.
Nominations be closed?
Should they be? Yes. Are the nominations closed? Great. All those in favor, say yay.
Yay.
Yay's a good word.
Keep your job there, like I bet you.
All those in favor, say no.
All those against, say no.
All those who abstain are back. Great, so it is unanimous, Cindy.
Well, thank you, and before we go any further, this will be my fifth year as chair. I just got re-elected for another 3 years from Conway, but this will be my last year as chair, because I think 5 years at any party is a pretty good run, but I also think it's time to kind of get some new blood in here and new thoughts in here, so just give it a thought, y'all have a year to think about it. I'm not leaving the committee, I just want to leave this chair, go somewhere else, so I thought it...
All right, Cindy, you know, we understand.
Okay.
It's not a bad, you know, it's not a bad thing to serve for 5 years. When I first came here, I used to run it.
Oh, did?
Waitley, Sunderland, Conway, and Deerfield, went around, and it's only a year, you suck it up and you do it for a year. That's the way, it was that way forever. And then somehow, I don't know where along the line, somewhere, I don't know, it was John Deere or somebody, right around that year, that it, nobody wanted to, it fell apart, because the town's turn it was to do it to Baltimore Town.
But they never made you chairman.
Moving along. So anyways, I just wanted to put that out there, and so we were totally clear on that. So I would like to take nominations for vice chair.
Mary Raymond, if you'd like to serve again?
I would just say I will serve, but if someone is thinking they would like to be chair next year, and they would like to be vice chair this year, that's fine, we can do.
Come on, then.
Do you want to be vice chair?
I can be vice.
Oh, okay.
I would love to get some experience.
So vice chair? You know you only get it if I'm not here, and I'm always here. Okay, just saying. Thank you, Bill. Okay, so can we...
Anyone else who's interested?
Nobody has second Mary's, so if we would like to...
Never been vice chair?
Somebody nominate Bill, please?
Bill Smith for vice chair.
Whoa.
Wait, there's no swimming, there's...
Oh, sorry, Bill Marapizzi?
Yes, Bill Marapizzi for vice chair.
Can I have a second?
Second.
All those in, any discussion? Are the nominations closed?
Nominations be closed.
Any discussion? Votes, all in favor? Yays? All boos, all opposed? Unanimous? Thank you very much. It'll be fun.
Thank you.
Secretary, do we nominate secretary? I'm sorry. Yeah.
Move Robert Hala.
Move Bob Hala, it was seconded by Bill Smith. Anybody want to close nominations?
Move nominations be closed.
Thank you. All those in favor? And done deal. Now, I do get to appoint a few people. So, and I haven't been able to talk to anyone before, so budget subcommittee, would those people who served on budget subcommittee last year still like to serve this year? We usually have one person from every town, so Phil Cantor from Conway. Mary, can you, would you do Deerfield? Bill, would you still do Waitley? And then I need a Sunderland person. Who did Sunderland last year?
Keith did.
Keith did, so we'll nominate Keith, or I'll appoint Keith, because he's not here? Okay, that works. And then,
It's been done before.
Representatives to the collaborative, I know that Lynn did a wonderful job last year. Lynn, I was wondering if you would mind doing that again this year, or... Okay, so Lynn, thank you very much. And Bob, you did Mars?
Yep.
Would you so do that again this year?
Didn't have to do anything.
Well, then I guess the appointment will be fine. Would you rather be on budget committee?
Mary's doing a fine job. If I want to camp out there, I will.
Okay, so all the appointments have been taken care of. We are now officially reorganized, and so we will move along and review and approve the minutes of June 14th. I do believe there's a couple changes that I know of, and on the first page where it says Patty Kavanaugh, business manager, presented the financial statement, Patty was not here, so we will have to change that to Marty Barrett, the superintendent, presented.
So done.
You've done it already?
Yep.
And then I, did we clear up the, on the last page, cafeteria report?
We cleared it up from black to red, yes.
From black to red, there was just one word, which was huge in that situation. Okay, so other than that, can I have a motion?
Motion.
To approve those minutes?
As corrected.
As corrected? Any other discussion on them?
Who seconded it?
I did.
Thanks, Bill.
All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous? Financial statements, Patricia Kavanaugh, our director of, I don't even know your official title, I'm sorry.
Director of Business Services.
Thank you.
When did we get that new title?
When I got a new contract.
There you go, big long fancy.
Chair Womet and Chair Cuddeback came up with that title.
I do remember talking. Okay.
So tonight you have warrants, which are signed, that total $4,963,627.95. Financial statements, the FY16s couldn't be presented because we're presenting the school lunch, so I can't give you the final from our general ledger till we deal with the school lunch, which we're going to deal with later. And then the FY17 statements, I do not have them tonight because we had a glitch with our Infinite Vision systems. So that's the bad news. The good news is I had a long talk with Dr. Carey, and I talked with my staff, and per Mr. Decker's longtime request, you will now get your financials ahead of the meeting. It won't go out in the packet because sometimes the month isn't completed when the packet goes out, but you will get it 24 to 48 hours prior to the meeting to review for the time of the meeting.
Excellent.
Welcome.
That's way too easy of a financial report.
Well, I've got other issues coming up down there.
Down the road.
Yeah. I'm going to suffer.
Okay. Are we good with that? So, public comments, seeing no public, we will move on. Report.
Just introduce Allison Walters, who is the new union president.
Hi, Allison.
Congratulations.
Welcome. She replaces Steffi Rieker, who did
Stephanie,
a fine job.
So Walters.
Welcome, welcome. See, we put you on the spot. Turn that camera. So report, student advisory. No one.
They are yet organized. They are not yet organized, rather, so they...
Okay, so we'll move along. So we're up to unfinished business, so I will turn it over to Dr. Carey for the central office relocation presentation.
Thanks, Cindy. What I'm going to do is have just a little history. When I came on the job, I was informed that the decision to move out of the Christian Lane building was already made. We had a subcommittee to look at three different areas, you know, what it would cost to stay in Christian Lane, what it would cost to go to Sandy Lane, and what it would cost to move to Frontier. We had a subcommittee that met several times. We went through all the cost of the three different scenarios. Frontier was the most reasonably priced, and it just seemed a better fit for an educational organization to be. It's a model that's in schools, especially regional schools all over this part of the state. So we brought that information to you last time. It was a joint meeting because, you know, information for everyone. It my understanding is it wasn't a surprise because we all knew that the decision had already been made to move. We came up with some costs. They were a little high, and we did have we weren't ready to talk dollars and cents where exactly that money would be coming from, but we are tonight. And we were also able to cut down the amount of money that it's going to take to move ourselves over here at the holiday time. And we are ready to move forward. I'm going to have Patty get into the details with you, and she has papers to hand out. I do want to point out that part of the cost of moving is also intertwined with updating the phone system in this whole building. And I think Darius can speak to the fact that the phone system, even this Monday, was down. And I do have a narrative for what happens, but essentially when all the circuits get used, they don't reset. So they don't open up. So parents calling are getting busy signals. because the phone system was installed in 96. They did a quick fix with the switch that failed in 2009, but it's not really up to date. And we would like to move forward with this whole building, not just because we're coming, but because it's a safety measure. It's necessary with a voice over internet phone system.
May I just say one thing before we talk about price or cost? I applaud this very difficult decision to move anywhere, but I can tell you that the energy here, that knowing the superintendent is moving to the school that all four towns send their kids to, the parent energy is amazing. I think that if we always have the kids on our top of our minds, this is a wonderful move. So the price part of things, I'm sure, is going to be a difficult conversation. But if we keep that in mind, that the parents of these kids are excited that the superintendent is coming.
Thank you. And I can speak for myself, I'm excited. And the rest of the office, they're not quite as, they have a lot of things that need to be shifted through and sifted through before they come, but it will be a positive move.
And I just wanted to add a slight correction to the subcommittee, the subcommittee thing. I went back, and our subcommittee met 8 separate times over the summer, and that was yeoman's work, so I just wanted to give a pat in the back to
Lisa. Very yep. True, very true.
You there is no really, I in teamwork.
You're right.
But thank you, and thank you for the hard work.
Y'all did.
It was hard work, and it is hard work. And people are still, had a long conversation today in my office. Don Skrosky came and sat in with us, and still, you know, this building, what can we do, you know? I mean, it's not ADA compliant, it doesn't have fire, it's not security, it's, there's asbestos everywhere, but we could still fix it, and it's very hard. It's just a hard thing, but we're moving on, and thank you.
So I'm going to hand these out, and while they're being passed down, while you have the chance to review them, I want to reiterate that in our joint meeting in the summer, I wasn't prepared with budget numbers because the decision wasn't made which way we were going. But I think the way that I said that I meant that in the best case scenario, we would have had a year to plan and budget. That's the best case, but is that the reality? No, it's not. So it's not that Dr. Carey did not plan for the financial piece of this. We weren't ready to present because there wasn't a decision made. So the money flows also from this committee, not the joint committee. Mm-hmm. So we also felt that that conversation should have been reserved for this committee. So there was some pushback that we seemed unprepared, and I just want to apologize to Dr. Carey publicly that was not my intention, to seem like that we were unprepared and my words were misinterpreted. So my apologies to Dr. Carey for that.
I appreciate that. I also just want to speak to the fact that we did call a special meeting in the summer, and it did seem rushed, but it was because Darius needed the approval to move. Were we going to come so that we could move the classrooms? Not move us, but move those classrooms during the summer so the students would not have been disturbed or disrupted in any way. So things just kind of sugared off the way they did, and we're moving on. Thank you.
So what I've done tonight is taken the budget, and I have broken it out into where the funding sources could be if that's where you so decide. So currently, we have $39,434.15 in what we call the central office repair article. And in over a series of 3 years, the towns were requested a sum of money to make some major repairs at 219 Christian Lane. What remains is this $39,000. So we conferred with our attorneys to see if we could use that money to move. And because the purpose is different from which the towns gave it, we have to go back to the towns and request them to utilize that money to move the central office. So those letters have been drafted and approved by the attorney, and you need to vote later this evening for the superintendent to send out those.
Permission of selectmen or permission of town meeting?
That's up to the, I don't, I'm not, that. Our attorney says it's probably gonna have to be on a warrant article on a town, a special or a annual town meeting. So The latest we will, if the town's vote, would be May, when Conway has their annual town meeting. So because of the timing of that money, we're planning on using that money for the new AC ductless mini splits, because we would probably be putting them in May. It would be a good time.
That's right.
And also, we would use it for the second and third phases of the phone system, because we come next summer is probably when we're going to be ready for the second and third phases of the phone system. Secondly, we also have $11,582.45 in our stabilization fund. You voted that money in about 2 or 3 years ago to take care of projects. So we thought we would best use that money to start the new upgrade for the phone system of $8,500, and also do the locks and security and a piece of the repairs, painting and signage. What the stabilization fund doesn't cover, we, for the repairs, painting and signage, we can do from our central office budget currently. We can make those changes to our budget and pick up that piece. So that leaves $28,000 that would probably have to come from excess and deficiency for the electrical upgrades and the data drops, hire a moving contractor, and purchase the workstations and partitions. After we made our allocations last year, we still have, from our FY15 excess and deficiency, we still have $103,226 available. So you could put $28,000 towards that move from that $103,000. Our FY16 excess and deficiency isn't yet certified. That's due in October. But I did do a quick calculation, and we're estimating to be about the same place we were last year, between like $250,000, $300,000 for FY16. So that's the plan as we've mapped it out. If you have any questions or comments.
What was the 103?
103,226 is the balance of our excess and deficiency from FY15.
Okay, but then we won't have anything in the excess and deficiency account until this funds are certified this year.
Right. So it, well, you'll have 103 less 28,000.
Yeah, we still have 28,000.
Yeah. Right.
All right. But we won't have anything left in stabilization.
Correct.
Okay.
I know you can't include it in the moving costs and the budget and everything, because who knows how, you know, if and how long, but can the Christian Lane building be sold?
I don't know the answer to that.
The answer to it is the town of Whaley conveyed it to the Frontier Regional School District. They kept the first right of refusal to buy that property if we go to sell it, okay? And the Frontier Regional School Committee has the first right of refusal to buy the remaining land there. If they choose to sell it, I doubt they're ever going to sell anything. But if we want to sell it, we have to basically contact the town of Whaley to find out if they're going to be interested. And if they want it for the dollar, they can have it. We just have to find a place to store what records that are going to be there for in the interim.
And we do have what we're planning to do with 219 Christian, and again, this is a decision that needs to be made, but our proposal would be to use Christian Lane for our file storage, so that we would be able to go back and forth. Now, there was concern from the committee about an abandoned building and the increase in insurance, and that is true. It would be an additional $7,000. However, I spoke to our insurance agent, and as long as we're using 31% of the square footage and someone visits weekly, and if we're going back and forth with files, there'll be multiple visits, we will not have to pay that additional $7,000. So Dr. Carey and I spoke with Bob Lesko, and we've also got a system-wide problem. We have to buy our paper in bulk, and all the schools have to take all the paper for the year at once, which means we're cluttered in the schools. We could also use, along with Frontier, of Christian Lane with file storage, we could also use it as a warehouse. So we would take all the paper in, and the custodians would take their paper as needed, and it would free up space in all the schools.
So, I missed last meeting. I wasn't here, but the meeting I was here prior to that, they were talking about, Marty Barrett was talking about electronic, moving everything to electronic records. Is that not the case anymore?
It's right now, it's not financially feasible, and I think our conversations have been, we would like to have a plan with our IT director to take our current records going forward rather than spending money on old records that we can get rid of after 7 years. So after 7 years, there should be no records left in that building except the permanent files that we are required to keep. And then what we really should focus on is going forward, because the old files will take care of themselves as we parse them out after our time limits.
We were looking at around $70,000 to have them go through.
I remember it was very expensive.
Right.
Yeah. It just also just seems, I don't know, like a waste to have a building just sitting with paper.
There is a facility down in the Worcester area run by a company called Iron Mountain that takes records, and they have a record management system where they come in and you put your records on a pallet, you make up a list of what's on that pallet, they shrink wrap it, and they take it to their facility. If you need something, you call them, they'll pull it because you'll made a record of where it is in the pile and the numbers, and they can pull the file and they can send it to you, or you can go down and actually physically look at it. I don't know what the charge would be, right. But we owe it to ourselves to investigate that cost to see whether that's going to be more cost effective than keeping the records in the Whately building and paying the overhead on that.
And
but you have to tread lightly till you figure it out.
Right. And I don't know.
It's expensive, but
it may not be. It may not be. When we have to look something up, it's usually for a teacher who's going to retire, and that information's needed quickly. So I don't know how convenient it's going to be for us to get all the data for a teacher that taught maybe in 1970, 1980, and have to find all their individual payroll records. How many pallets would we have to request? How much time does that take? Because they're waiting to retire, and of course, we know that teachers do a great job of planning. They want to go in June, and they call us on June 1st. So it's a turnaround issue sometimes, too. Sorry, Cindy.
No, that's okay. I was raising my hand, calling myself. So so we can leave those there and say we're projecting long-term goal as 7 years, and then we can do something within that 7 years that changes that.
Correct.
7 years, but right now for at least 1 year or maybe 2 years, we can leave them there and move everything else along, and then be able to more target, narrow what we're going to do with them instead of trying to take on the move and this and everything else. So I don't know that we have to vote on that, but just leaving them there for at least a year or so is probably not the worst idea.
As long as we get them out.
Because we know where they are.
As long as we get them, once the move is done, we get them out of the basement.
Correct.
Bring them up and put them like in the lunchroom. Yeah.
But then it's very fluid with what we do with them.
Yeah, I just hope there's foresight thinking forward, mm-hmm. that, you know, you don't just have a building of
that's paper sitting there,
you know, 10 years, yeah. 20 right. years, and it's still
no, a, seven's
a, rotting,
max.
A rotting building.
The move makes no sense if that's the case. No.
Right.
No,
right.
That wouldn't be.
And that's why we figured if we're going to spend that kind of money, let's take care of our current records going
correct.
Forward so that we can stop the problem.
Yeah, okay.
Where are we on that, on the forward part?
We're implementing.
Because I'm not the only one thinking about it.
Dr. Carey is going to talk about PowerSchool. Our IT department is all on getting PowerSchool right now. So it is on the agenda, but it's not a priority at this moment.
But PowerSchool will also be a major part of that records retention digitally.
Well, just one of my concerns, though, is this, the long-term history of central office expenditures has been sort of a loss of inertia. And you know the reason that the $39,000 is there is because the projects approved, mm-hmm. just were never undertaken. They were at first, remember that, and then
we budgeted. We figured it was going to cost $50,000, but the bids came in at $39,000. So there was extra money on some of those bids when we had those repairs done. We weren't right to the T spending $50,000 for $50,000 worth of windows. So there was times that there was money there that the bids came in cheaper. So that money is why we got $39,000 more so than undertaking other projects. I think we completed all the big.
You did everything you said you were going to do.
Well, I thought there was one. It was my understanding there was one thing, and that was the expansion to the third floor. And then we found out that it wasn't possible. So that became.
But I don't think any. Bill could probably remember that. I don't remember anything ever talked about the third floor because it was hell to even get up there.
So I guess, you know, I guess where I was going with this is that is there a mechanism in place to sort of keep, you know, once the move is undertaken, the pressure's off, and is there a mechanism without the school committee bringing this up every month and asking you for progress on it? Are you developing a mechanism to make sure that 7 years is the and that there's progress on this back room stuff that nobody really sees?
So why don't we ask to get a quarterly report as to what's happening so it doesn't get lost?
Correct.
And we could do that, definitely. We need to get an abatement company to come in and move the records that we need to keep. But there are records down there, acres of records, that I'm pretty positive we don't need to. So we also need to find a way to shred, you know, to destroy these records that we've had from, well, essentially from the 50s. I mean, I'm not saying back in the 30s, but the 50s, the 60s, there's employee records from the 60s. I mean, people were making like $3,000 or $4,000 a year, and pretty interesting stuff. But the biggest concern for leaving the building is the boiler is not, it's not healthy. It's just not, we don't think it's going to last. And replacing that would be $85,000 to $100,000. And again, the ADA, we know it's not compliant. So that's.
And our concern about that was that the Board of Health could possibly, if it fails and you're still the owner, there was issues about whether the Board of Health could compel you to furnish the building, to heat the building and not let whatever, that we had concerns about those issues.
Okay, Judy?
I guess I'm going to tag on to Phil's thought. So I'm trying to understand. I get the day-to-day, like, the people shouldn't be in the building. So that part I 100% get. What I don't get is the back and forth. So the people that can't be in the building still can't be in the building. So moving the moldy records up from the basement onto another floor and then requiring that somebody go in and access them, I don't really fully understand that plan. I 100% agree with the quarterly updates plan, because we're looking at 2024, fiscal year 2024, if it's a 7-year plan. Which seems like really far away, but it's actually probably not.
2024.
And I don't 100% get the whole, like, we're going to use it as storage, but we're not going to heat it. So then the people that are going in, if they're going in the winter, they're going into a cold building that's already moldy, dirty, dusty, gross.
We have to keep minimal heat on, just so we're all understanding this, because you can't have ice freezing. No.
Okay, but Patty, if you need to go get a record, you don't want to work in the building now. I'm using you as an example. Okay. I'm not, by the way, stating any. I have no knowledge of your personal experience.
He personally said nothing.
Yep, no knowledge of your personal experience. Okay, Patty needs to go get a record. You have to go in, but you're not comfortable in the building. Do you send somebody else? Like, how do you pass on that responsibility to be in a building that we don't want you to work in, but you still need to go in?
I think there's just, Lynn, there's a difference, Judy, I'm sorry. There's a difference between being in there 8 to 10 hours a day and being in there for 15 minutes.
Also, correct me if I'm wrong, the people we're going to have come in there and do the abatement, the shredding, we're not going to bring all those moldy boxes up. We're going to get rid of the moldy boxes. We're going to put these things into new boxes. Are the records damaged? It could be, but at least we're not going to bring up moldy boxes. We're going to get rid of all. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. We're going to get rid of them. And we're going to put the records in nice, clean, stackable boxes.
Essentially, we're going to leave many, we're bringing many, but we're leaving many filing cabinets. And in these filing cabinets, for instance, there are a lot of special ed files, student files. They're confidential. Students who have graduated, but we still need to keep their records for any kind of claim or any information that people need. A lot of those will be staying. The current special ed students that we service now will come with us in file cabinets. There's other file cabinets with employee, the ones in the cellar are from the employees from the 60s and the 70s, but we also have current employees, all those files. if they're not working currently working with us right now,
they'll be staying there, but we often have to refer to them for a multitude of reasons. People call, they want, you know, employee checks, they want to know when they were working or whatever. There's also a lot of the accounts payable, a lot of these other forms that every once in a while they need to refer to, how much did we spend when we, and that kind of thing. So the, a bulk of those things are in file cabinets that will stay in the building for now.
Yeah, I get that. I guess I don't want, number one, I don't want it to become a records graveyard that we never go back to. And number two, I don't want to continue the problem for the employees that had to work there for as long as they did, because it maintains, because it does stay a record graveyard.
I think that's part of letting them make a plan and then maybe presenting that to us down the road, but the real tough stuff about moving needs to be taken care of. And so I hate to say this, if no one has anything else to say, because I don't want to encourage it, I'm going to have to think of a different way to put that sentence. I think we should move on so that we can... Oh, did you wait? No. Mary.
So you have heat on for minimal heat, and what happens when the boiler does break down?
Well, we are going to... go first, Mr. Lesko will be doing a building check on Mondays and Fridays as he goes home. I mean, we already sort of, we do this now between Bob and I. We check the building in the winter. Bob usually checks it all winter long when the heat, during heating system, he's there on the weekends. Like if he happens to be driving by, he will check in. That's not gonna change. We could also invest a little bit of money, $2,000-$3,000, to put an alarm on that would notify us if something should happen to the heat. If it drops below a certain temperature, that would, you know, phone call Bob or myself. So those types of things aren't going to change.
In addition, moving the records upstairs, particularly into the kitchen room or the meeting room, the large room, they'll all be there. And Bob Holla had mentioned, too, if the furnace fails, we can also set up some heating.
Portable electric.
Yes, portable electric heating. Just to keep it at an even 50 or 60.
Bill, since you are old water guy, I mean, if no one's really using the water in this place, can the water be shut off and everything be drained, or is that how the boilers?
Steam.
Oh, okay.
So somebody's got to go by and check to put the water in the boiler every day.
No, it's automatic feed.
Is it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's dangerous.
But I think if there are,
you gotta pay your
there are things that you can do to. Set up a light and a strobe light or something else that runs
well,
off the battery.
We call the watchman.
We have that on the septic, and the neighbors aren't really a fan of it.
Well, but we're talking about the main electricity for the whole thing, that if the if the heat drops to a certain thing, you sell them?
Yeah, we sell them. It gets below 50 degrees, and your light comes on in the window. I mean, we call them watchmen.
I say we should take the lightning rod off the top of the building and lightning might solve
the
problems.
No. Be... I will tell you a story about.
Wait. My question was really, how if boiler dies, how are we going to pay for it? You still have to.
Yeah, put some
Bob.
Hold on, Bob.
Baseboard electric.
We would have to talk to Mr. I don't think we've gotten that detailed, Mary. It's the same question. If we stay there and that boiler dies, what do we all do to go to work? I mean, we've been living on this thread for many years. This is the beginning of my fifth year. I understand that.
Mary, as far as I'm concerned, at that time, if that boiler does go, the water will be shut off, and somehow we drain the system, and we have some portable thing just for that one room. The sun comes in there full bore all day long. It's hot in that room any given day during the year, as far as I can remember. I mean, shut the water off, drain everything. That way no pipes freeze. And then all we have is paper storage. It's not like, you know, it's not like it's anything else.
It's still
else.
Going to be an expense to that.
Well, yeah, it just draining. I mean, Bill knows about draining systems and stuff.
We always have to keep that.
Yeah.
But again, I think that's something that, along with the file storage, we do need to come up with a plan of what we're going to do with the building if the boiler fails.
Why don't we agree to go down and try to fix out a system?
Why don't you tell everybody?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you volunteering for something?
Why doesn't Phil and Bob and I go down and see if we can isolate the thing and how to try to work this thing?
Yeah. What do you mean? Work the boiler?
No, on a contingency plan on how to come up with some alternatives.
So I think that's a great offer if you want to volunteer, but I agree with a little bit of the murmuring going on. I think we need to leave this now and get on with other business because we're doing what it could have should us. And
yeah,
maybe we should move it back.
Gives
so I think, yeah. So we never really totally discussed the superintendent sending the correspondence. So that appears it needs a vote. So if you would like to speak to that anymore, or if you guys think that you talk sufficiently.
So
there's no
because we are not using the money for the purpose for which it was given, we have to ask permission from the towns to use that money for the purpose of moving. And it has to go on a warrant article. So I have done the research. I found the original town warrant articles. Donna and I did the research. We have the letters drafted. We will include a copy of their original warrant. We've allocated the money in the same vein from the warrant articles in which it was given. So each town is going to get an allocation of this 39, and we're going to be asking permission to use it to move.
Total cost to each town is zero.
Correct. All they're saying is yes, you can use it, or no, you can't. And then I don't know where we go. If it's no, we can't, I haven't discussed with the attorney if that means we then have to return the money. So we're not.
Raise the letter so that you really don't give them the arms.
I tried to do that, but it kind of got, you know, the attorney revised it.
The only question, you said for moving, but you're really spending it from the HVAC because you had already moved by.
Right. Correct.
Yeah.
So I'll entertain a motion.
The relocation cost.
Yeah. Motion, please, that the superintendent be allowed to send these letters.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Opposed? Abstain? One abstention? And moving on. Cafeteria report?
Can I just ask a question? So are we tabling the money funding, or?
We have no vote that was registered on the agenda to take for that, so I guess we're going to have to table that until.
We have a joint meeting, and then we don't meet again until November, and the plan is to move it at over Christmas, and that's going to be a little late.
You can still take a vote, even if it wasn't on the agenda. It's foreseeable that a vote might be missed.
I make a motion to have a vote.
I agree with that. It would be foreseeable that we would have to take a vote on that. So the fact that it's not on the agenda was just somebody forgot to put it on. Anybody got a problem with that? No? Nope. Moving on. So we're going to vote to allocate this money. Does somebody want to give me the motion, Patty, for this vote that we need to take?
Moving costs.
Okay. The school committee votes to use $11,582 from stabilization. $28,000 from excess and deficiency, as well as the $39,434, if appropriated back from the towns, to be used to relocate the central office from 219 Christian Lane in Waitley to Frontier Regional School.
Could somebody so move that?
So move.
Thank you. Can I have a second?
Second.
Discussion. Any further discussion on that?
Can you we haven't talked about the 4,100, and you didn't put it in the vote, so.
We got it in the budget already.
Oh, I'm sorry, Judy, that's a good point. So the balance of replacing the analog handsets in all the classroom, we can put that in our FY18 budget, and that would be about $4,100, and we'll put that last expense in our FY18 budget to finish doing the classroom work. That's the third phase of the implementation of the phone system. So we have time to budget for that in FY18.
So we're not spending it now, we'll be spending it later.
Correct.
Okay. Go ahead.
You got all these things tied together, the 28th, 11582, and the 39434. And that 39434 is not a given by any means.
It was a contingent.
I understand that, but you've got them all tied together in the same article.
It takes
forever. Town meeting, towns are not going to call a special meeting for you, special town meeting for you for this.
No, they're not.
You're going to get on their warrant when they feel like doing it.
So we need more motions, separate motions.
Okay.
I wouldn't couple that 39434 with the other two. If you want to go do the other two things,
the 11 and the 28.
That's fine, but I wouldn't tie my wagon to that horse.
Yeah, you said you don't need the 39 right away, right?
Correct. That's,
so okay, so we've got an amended motion to remove the 39,434 from the motion.
Let's do it from the beginning straight up.
Okay, so
move 11,582 from the stabilization fund to fund the locks and security, the repairs, painting, and signage, and the phone upgrade.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's one motion. Then the next one.
Okay, let's do that motion. You got Bill had the second.
Okay.
Any other discussion on that $11,582?
Hold on.
Except for the guy writing.
Well, I only got so much room on this piece of paper, and already we've changed it three times. So I know, Bill. I know.
Use this one.
That's all right.
Pencil, Bob.
Okay.
So the motion was made by Bob Decker and seconded by Mr. Smith.
Yes. Correct.
I'll help you with the verbiage after that.
We're going to have a vote.
All those in favor? Opposed? Not voting? Unanimous. Okay, so now we need to take one on the 28,000.
No. Some,
yes, we just took it on the 11,582.
Okay, move the 28,000.
From excess and deficiency?
From the excess and deficiency, the current excess and
to
deficiency.
To pay for?
FY15.
Well, it's actually the existing E&D money that we have.
Okay, well, you can argue about the verbiage.
I know where it came from, really, but we already spent some of it.
You want to list it out, what we're paying the $28,000 for?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's all there. Can I have a second? Second, Bill?
Who made the motion?
Bob Decker.
Second. You didn't make the motion, you did the second. We can't double tap. Okay, so any other discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Okay, so then we just leave this one right totally out, the 39,000. Okay. All right.
Once we get through the town meetings, then we can
Okay, so we have voted that anyway. So now we move along to cafeteria report. Everybody good with that? And good.
I guess that's still me. Okay.
I know,
so
really.
This was something that was put on the June agenda without them knowing that I was not going to be here in June. So I brought it forward to this meeting. And this has been a two-year problem. And we were hoping that the first year that this occurred was an anomaly. And it wasn't. It reoccurred again this year. So I'm going to hand this out for you to look at. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
I'm sorry.
Paperwork. It's more than one page.
So in FY15, we had a loss of $35,850 in our school lunch fund. And in FY16, we have a loss of $64,112. So in 1 year, our loss jumped about $28,000. And the second page is part of the reason I couldn't give you the final report for 16 is because I wanted to show you this. So this is the school lunch P&L. And I cannot leave the $64,000 in the negative. So I didn't give you the other financials because we need to use money from our general fund to cover these losses. So I wanted you to see this. So what we're going to do, what the plan is to do, is that we are going to take salaries from our general fund budget, move them to our school choice budget, and then move some of the salaries from the cafeteria onto the general ledger budget. It's not a good idea to use school choice funds to fund a cafeteria, but you can use school choice funds to use teacher salaries. So we're going to make those two adjustments.
Okay.
And then this will be down to zero. But the issue is going forward. So as you can see, the difference in the loss is mostly in our revenue. And this isn't unique to Frontier. This is a systemic issue that we're having in all of our cafeterias in the Frontier Regional Union 38 schools. So this was an issue that Mrs. Barrett and I started on and didn't finish. And Dr. Carey and I have had some preliminary conversations. And what we would like to do is put a committee together of myself, Dr. Carey, the high school principal, and maybe a principal from one of the elementary schools, and come up with a plan to see why this is happening.
I have the answer.
You do.
The food's terrible.
And that's...
Smile at the camera when you say that.
Sorry.
And Phil, that's what we need to dig into.
We play a game house at dinner time. It's guess what was on the menu today by using the photo. I'm always wrong.
Well, we had the first meeting last night in Waitley, Phil. So just to let you know, we're in the red also in figuring out how to do it. But we have 65% participation in our school lunches, which averages 70, I guess. So I didn't think 65 was that bad, but I forgot what the dollar figure. This is a lot of money at 65. I thought ours was a lot. This is a lot.
Do you have those figures, the percentages of like the grammar schools that participate?
And that is what we need to do. So when we had a couple of DESE audits last year, and we need to go back in and educate ourselves on what these metrics are measuring and how are we not hitting our target. So they tell us the target percentage is 70% of participation, that 70% of your student body should be participating in school lunch. Okay. Now, I don't know if that's necessarily true in a school district where we are large in farming, where a lot of people grow their own food. I don't know that they grow their own food and then buy lunch. I don't know that. It could be an anomaly in the type of communities that we're in.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that I know we will never hit is that they measure us on is meals per service hour. So they take the number of hours of people divided by the number of meals you're serving. We're always going to be higher than the average because we have such small schools. I can't staff a Waitley cafeteria with less than two people. One has to serve and one has to do the register. So are we overstaffed? Absolutely, according to the metrics we are. But how do I have one person serve and cash out at the same time? It doesn't work. So these are things that we really have to start digging into and come up with a plan to how we're going to fix this systemically.
Bill?
Two questions. We are required by law to serve lunch?
Yes.
Second question, do you have any idea what this kind of a deficit would do to the price?
The price
of lunch.
We're at the high school, we're at $2.75 or $3 even.
But to try to treat this like a business and make it cost effective, you pay for what you produce. I just wondered what kind of impact this would have on the price.
If we took that and absorbed
it. I'd have to count the number of meals that we served.
I just wondered if that had been kicked around at all. I'm just curious is it going to double the price? What is it going to do?
Bob?
According to this, if I read it correctly, you spent you had $149,000 in change in revenue.
Mm-hmm.
Your salaries for the cafeteria was $142,000.
Yes.
So that only left you $7,000 to buy food, and your food cost you, the food and the expenses there cost more money.
$70,000,
yes. Yeah. So, there's got to be a problem. Either you've got too much help, right? That's right. My think is you have to look at what you're carrying for staff. I mean, if you're only bringing in $149,000 and you got $142,000 in salaries,
and that's high,
it's
that,
never going to flow.
That's high. That is high, Bob. But mostly, if you look at our expenses, basically held the same. They flip flop between the food costs and the salaries. But the most of our loss was directly related to a loss of revenue, which means the kids aren't buying our lunches.
Well, then we need to reduce staff to only carry enough of staff to produce the number of meals.
Correct.
Or we need to go brown bag or bring in one of those educational companies that wants to.
And this is what this committee is going to investigate and bring forth some recommendations to how we can fix our lunch program.
Do you know what the percentage is? You give it to us and wait.
I don't have the metrics for it.
That's right.
I haven't done the statistics.
I do know. I have been approached about this by one of Conway's selectmen, because Sodexo Marriott, the large corporation, does all of the corrections cooking for Massachusetts, and they have one very large central kitchen, and they're trying to expand into schools, and they are marketing to select boards guaranteeing to save education dollars by closing schools' cafeterias in exchange for signing a contract and getting a low sum, da da da. Once you close your cafeteria, of course, right, you're at their mercy.
Right. So I've been in two school districts where we outsourced, and I've been in a school district where in two districts where we run our own programs. When you go outside, what's going? And I've talked to Mrs. Barrett about this, and I've talked to school committees. They will come in and they will only cook at Frontier, and they will close the other four satellites. And I don't know that the parents would accept that, because in the other districts I've been in, when you close cafeterias, then you get, my child bought lunch, it's cold, it's not warm. Mm-hmm. So how do you cook at Frontier and drive the meals to Conway and make sure they stay hot? Now we have to buy a hot truck.
Mm-hmm. That's worse food than what we currently have. Prison food is worse food than what we have now.
So what are you all proposing to do to form your own committee and check into this?
And then we'll come back with recommendations to all, maybe at the second joint committee meeting.
All.
And the second joint is in October?
No, that's the first.
Oops, sorry.
The April. Second one is in April, I believe.
Oh, all right. So it's not a quick fix.
I think you're going to want to handle it prior to that.
Sorry.
We're going to be working on it, Bob.
Mr. Holland?
One of the things they brought up last night at our meeting was that the schools right now buy their own food. We could buy it cheaper if we all got together and bought our food, mm-hmm, too. Yep. That's one of the things that
so it'd was be brought, the same menu in
same,
all five
same
schools.
Same menu every week, every day at all four schools or five schools, and that way everything would be, you know, cost efficient.
Buying in bulk.
You know, we're gonna have chicken fingers up in Conway, we're gonna have chicken fingers everywhere.
It is a little different at the high school level. The high school food service is never the same as an elementary, middle school. If you go into most renovated cafeterias in high schools, they look like mall food courts, because at the high school level, it's all about marketing. You have to market your food. You have to make it, and our kids are pretty savvy. They want healthy choices.
Okay. Darius, do you think our food is good here?
No. Would you eat it?
I'll buy it.
It could be improved.
Okay.
Keeping in mind that that's not reflected on the cafeteria staff. That's reflective on where they have to order their food from and what type of food they have to order.
Right.
So
absolutely.
Let's make that perfectly clear. Our cafeteria staff themselves are fantastic people who work really, really hard. Okay. So moving along, if there's no other...
Well, I think...
So capital improvements. Oops, sorry, Mary?
Well, I was going to say that, you know, if you look at the 15 to the 16 figure, your revenues dropped 28,000, but your salaries went up 5,600. Now, I don't know if you hired additional staff or you just gave them all a raise, but, you know.
That's the raises.
Well.
Don't say you gave them a raise.
You gave them a raise. You voted it.
That's right. We voted it.
Did we actually take a vote on the cafeteria?
Yes, you do. Is there on the sheet I give you?
Yes. Anyway, but my point is, you lost customers.
Yeah. I think that's our biggest situation, is we lost revenue.
There's got to be some surveys or something sent to these parents to get some feedback.
In this school, you won't be parents filling out, it'll be the kids filling out.
Yeah. Well, you got to get the feedback and find out how
Mary,
to
get, did you
let them see if they can come up with an idea.
So I was just wondering, you talked about bringing things back at the second meeting in April. Anticipation of next year, but if there's anything to stop the loss this year, maybe that can be looked at as well.
And I'm going to be meeting with our food service, and we're going to be looking at all these numbers, and hopefully we'll be able to put some stopgap measures in.
Judy,
when we get the information at the joint meeting, will we get the elementary school information as well as the?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because it's a systemic issue.
Yep.
Right.
I was just curious if participation rates are higher.
They are.
There you go.
Conway's the highest.
I know. I have one.
Go, Con. Capital improvements?
We actually don't have a report.
Alrighty.
Well, could I ask a question about that? Because
but they're not reporting on it, so can we wait until they
Well, the minutes from last time they had the list of capital projects. Was that
in our minutes?
That wasn't that talked about last meeting prior to this, the a list at the end of the year, list of things that we wanted to do. I thought that's what this would.
I will tell you this. Bob Lesko, I've been meeting with him, and we're going to actually come up with a 5-year plan for capital improvements. Bob will be meeting with every principal of all the schools, and he will be going through item by item and making a 5-year plan. And that's due to come to the board, the selectmen, school committees in November. So that's what we're working on. That's in the works now. He has not been able to meet with all the principals as of yet, but he will be before the November. He'll have a report for every select.
Plan sounds great.
Thank you.
Funding the plan sounds even better.
Well,
okay.
But I think what Phil was referring to is that you did receive a list of things that he was looking for money, and it says that you were going to do it at the September meeting, but
it's
maybe
not
if we're going to present that in October with that.
November.
But,
November.
But so there is a list that you guys have that he did hand out at the last meeting.
Mm-hmm. And we're just going to pretty that up and prioritize it.
And I think he's already taken, well, now the list is out, because I know we bought some of this stuff. So mm-hmm. we prioritize some of it, and then some of it's still on, but it's about $100,000 worth
of. So we need to have Bob there.
Kind of things.
Okay, well, thank you.
Yeah. We hope to have a real concise report coming.
Okay, new business. Regional Transportation Revolving Account. Who's got that one?
I'm sorry.
New Business Regional Transportation right. Revolving
okay.
Account.
So 2 years ago, this committee adopted the Regional Transportation Fund, and what we do is every year we need to take a vote to move the excess money into that fund, and that's what this vote is for. So in the packet, you'll see my calculation. That for FY16, the cherry sheet anticipated that we would get $214,246. I don't trust the cherry sheets, so I take what I reported from my end of the year report in 15 at $271,952, and I lowball that and say we're gonna get 53% because it is a legislative decision and mm-hmm. we don't know. The other reason I tend to budget conservatively is that in December, as we will be finding out this year, I hear already, when the governor has to make 9C cuts because the revenues haven't come in, then this transportation fund has been one of the things that they've cut. Now, Mars did bring a lawsuit that said, because somewhere it said that if you don't touch the Chapter 70, then you're not supposed to be touching the regional transportation. Mm-hmm. And they've been getting away with doing that. So the last time that this was threatened, we had a school district that had to cut $1 million in December to make the regional transportation. So with the advent of this fund, I tend to budget low so that anything else will come in and then we use it as a credit against the assessments in the next year. So we actually got $198,694, which was 73% was what it was funded at. Mm-hmm. And that means we had excess in our regional transportation of $54,641. So you need to vote to move that money into the Regional Transportation Fund. And then what will happen is when we go to do our assessments for FY18, that money will be used as a credit to the towns and lower their transportation assessments.
So moved.
Second. Any other discussion? Questions? Hearing none? All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Summer building maintenance update.
Darius, do you have
anything? Did you sweep the floors this summer?
I mean, as part of my principal report, I had they did a great job cleaning up the building, and they kind of whacked away at a few things on the list. There's still a long list that we have to get through where the building's getting, as I think, terming it, getting tired in certain areas. But they did a great job cleaning up this building and got it ready to go. So happy about that.
It's included a lot of classroom walls.
And a lot of classroom moves, and overall, the staff on that were very receptive of the move. It was not I wasn't sure if I was going to be twisting arms and having people kicking and screaming regarding the moves, but so far it's been received pretty positively. In fact, I haven't had really any formal complaints to me regarding it.
Formal
complaints, meaning like, you know, besides, you know, having to move this or, you know, something's not exactly where they wanted it right away, but it was it went pretty smoothly. Or very smooth, not pretty smooth.
IT is moved upstairs.
we are considering, I think we're going to do it, is there's a mini split in at 219 Christian Lane, a mini split air conditioner that's downstairs for the server that we use currently. That's going to come out and go into the IT room. And so we're going to be doing that. And so there's some odds and ends that have been taken care of. But again, we'll have a much more thorough report in November on all the details that we'd like to do. This building's getting a little bit older.
Delegates? You're going to talk about delegates?
Personnel update. We have paperwork. I don't know if everybody else got paperwork. It was in your packet, so it should be in there somewhere. I don't know what you all want to say about it. If anything. Self-explanatory.
Information only.
Yep. And Mass Joint Conference delegate. We're going to need to vote on that. If anyone is interested in going.
Move to appoint Mr. Decker as a voting delegate.
Second.
Second.
Bill, you can have it.
You should get an alternate, too.
Does anyone want to be an alternate?
Is anyone else going
to? I'm not going to attend this year.
It looks like I'm going to be able to go, but not Wednesday, and that's when that meeting is, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I won't be able to get there until Thursday.
Okay, you're on your own,
Bob.
And Donna knows you're going. Good.
Okay, so no other discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much. And all kidding aside, truly appreciate you doing this. Truly appreciate
it. Going down on Tuesday.
Oh, it's a free couple days away from your wife.
No, it really is, and he brings back good information. So I really do want to
say. Going down on Tuesday because there's a meeting on regional school stuff.
Excellent.
12:30 on Wednesday. And I'm not getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning.
To drive down. I don't blame you.
I should be very vocal.
Reports. Committee chair would be I actually have a report tonight, or a thought. I was reading the audit, scary enough. I know. And every single time they do an audit on us, they put in there that we are not signing our warrants the way we're supposed to be signing our warrants. And we, the last time the guy didn't even read it to us, we get told it, we have little discussion in that. So I am. I came early and I asked Patty, is there anything we can do about this? Like maybe check with the auditor and see how they want us to do this. Should we sign them, I don't know, sign them weekly, how many people have to sign them, what the rules are. So I asked her if I brought it up tonight, if we could at least get that ball rolling and then maybe ask for volunteers if necessary to stop by central office, wherever it may wind up being, when it is, and sign it. So
all they really want is for the warrants to be signed before the checks go out.
Correct. So I wound up asking her if she could check into it because I didn't want to put her on the spot tonight to have an answer that's just not nice. So
I will talk to our auditors and I will have them draft for us what they would recommend as the best
scenario for that type of stuff. Is everybody okay with that? That bugs me that it shows up every year and we have this little discussion on it and then goes away until the next time.
I remember when the gentleman was here, that was the guy that I heckled because he was chewing gum. Right?
So that's how I remember him.
So
anyway.
I think what that report recommended was that we have a subcommittee on warrants.
Possibly a subcommittee. I don't remember that part. I just remember reading that and thinking I have to ask.
And that the part about that is that to me there has to be someone there to answer questions about it. It's not just meet and sign warrants in advance. It's meet and
right.
I mean, otherwise.
So again, for her to ask what the best procedure might be is, I think, where we should go instead of trying to solve it.
But I think you want to avoid having to hold a meeting to do it, because then you're going to have to post it. Every one of them.
Right. So try to avoid that. Yeah. Thank you. That's all I had. Collaborative, Lynn?
Don't meet until the 28th.
Okay. Thank you.
Short meeting.
Business principal, you did part of yours.
All right. We have a brief one. That's a damn one. So I'll read through it. It's not that I know some of you are waiting on, but it's not a at some of the stuff we already talked about. So I wanted to thank the custodial staff, and I know Dr. Kerr is going to talk about the IT department as well, but they did a wonderful job. They worked a long summer. And I also mentioned an opening day. I wanted to, and I didn't put it here, but I mentioned an opening day to the all the staff, is the special education programs that ran all summer. I want to publicly thank them. There's teachers that work 6 weeks of the summer for students who had educational plans that required summer services, and they include nursing and other staffing. So I didn't put that as number one, but I wanted to thank them this summer because we had a busy summer there. I did a list of the new hires. It's a little bit different than what you had in your packet because it kind of explains there were some moving to move somebody else, kind of shifting. And I won't read through each one of them, but you can kind of read through it to see where the movements have taken place. So that also added to the number of moves the maintenance had to move, not just moving for the preparing for the central office move over here, but we also had a lot of moves happening anyways. So it was a busy summer there. Something new is that our student handbooks are now online. We make all high schoolers sign off that they understand they can access the student handbook online, and middle schoolers get them as part of their agenda. I can get you a copy of the middle school agenda with the handbook in it if you wish, or it's also accessible online. But usually at this meeting, I usually hand out the handbooks, but I'm not sure anybody really, a lot of them were handed back in the past few years. So if you want one, I can get you one.
Is it accessible online? Is it right
Yes, it's right on the front page. Student handbooks
comes student up.
And it has the date, and every year we change that.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. We've had two events of noteworthy that's happened or is about to happen this year so far. We did take the athletic team captains to Rambled Wild again, Scott Dredge and I, the assistant principal for a leadership training, and that was a successful trip. And our Morris Hill trip for the 7th grade is going to be the 21st. And open house is Thursday the 29th.
Oh, wow.
The other thing I left out on here as it was being brought up was Power School. Parents will be notified next week. We hope to get the mailing out to get their accounts for Power School up and ready. Right now, there would be nothing for them to access as we're getting things moved over and teachers learning how to set up their systems. So I kind of purposely delayed it so that when they get the letter, they can open up and actually see something rather than, you know, hit refresh. And then you can see the upcoming dates of early release days would start this Friday as well. That's all I got.
Any questions? Go ahead.
Power School replace
Edline? It does, yes. And I mentioned that in my opening letter to parents in the back-to-school packets that we are replacing Edline, and so it will be an ongoing, you know, this point forward, you won't have to renew your Power School. We'll renew it. Refresh your kids as they go through. So once you get an account, you get that going through. So I'll send that information out, and then I'll also do a robocall so that they know important information is coming and that kind of thing. And then just like Edline, kids will have their own way to get in, and parents will have their own way to get in to see grades and that kind of thing. And Power School has so many more features for teachers to extend their classroom, extend communications using it from what Edline could do. It's not this double login, really search and find. I found it. What's the word I'm looking for?
Tedious.
I found it tedious for parents to go in and see grades for each class. You really had to work at the new system. It's very simple. Click, click, click. You can see it all.
The superintendent's report?
Great. I'm going to hand these out. Does Westfield use PowerShell?
Yes.
Great. So.
Yeah, we went through the angst of having to learn it. I was just telling Judy, for teachers, I found it unnecessarily cumbersome at first. Now I've used it for several years, and now I don't even think about it, and I hardly remember what we had before. Now I find it pretty easy to use.
Mm-hmm.
But we went through some ugly times where we
all well. Right, get ready.
Surprise.
The learning curve
Allison,
is difficult.
Don't listen to her.
I already know this.
I've already given my phone number.
And you know, I say that all the time. I've been saying it in the central office. After we're in the high school 6 months, you won't even remember what it was like to be somewhere else because it'll become part of our daily life. And I also warned Darius in 6 months from now, he won't remember life before me. So there's...
I don't know, you'll be in the same building as him, so...
You'll be like, oh, hey, I don't remember what it was like to be. So I'm not sure if this is a grammatically correct sentence, but from my many, many first days of school, we had a wonderfully smooth opening district-wide. The children were just ready, and walking through the buildings, it's like they're already back into the swing. It didn't take long for them to just get back into it. I don't know if it's because it was the extended summer or what, but they seemed really ready from what I could see. And I did not get any phone calls, which I was thrilled. So I think it was a very smooth opening. A couple of little snafus, but we took care of them. The enrollment, which I believe you have in your packet for Frontier, is down by 2 students. Last year we had 650, this year we have 650, and last year we had 617. There's 15 students in grade 9 that are going to Franklin County Technical School and one to Smith Volk. In 10th grade, 4 students transferred to Franklin County Technical School and one to Smith Vocational. So our students, you know, there's quite a few that are leaving, but they're going, you know, to technical school, which is great for them.
Not a charter school.
No, it's not a charter school. So it helps us, you know, it makes me feel more comfortable knowing that they're just taking an alternative kind of education that, I've been busy completing my interviewing, my data gathering, and I'm compiling a report now that will be delivered during the October joint meeting. I hope the meeting won't be too long. But I did talk when I was interviewed and hired that I would do an entry plan. I needed to gather information to come up with where I want to go, what makes us so wonderful, and what the stakeholders are invested in this district. And I'm telling you, I've got some wonderful, wonderful feedback. What do you expect from me as your superintendent? I have many, many suggestions, and so I'm gathering all that data to hand out to everyone, and where do I go from now? And I already have a few ideas, and but the first year of a superintendent, you don't walk in and, you know, you ask questions, you learn, and you get to know things and get to understand the traditions and the people. I have been making some pretty serious decisions, but nothing that has any serious impact on anyone's day-to-day duties. So... The Massachusetts Association of School Committees is meeting in Cape Cod on November 2 to 5, and of course Bob will be there. But what I'm really most excited about is the IT Power School Information System update. The integration phase, moving from Redeker to Power School, is complete, and I will tell you the IT team worked doggedly all summer. Scott Paul worked, and his team. They all have just the most professional, hardworking team I've ever really worked with. And they've done the integration. They've made sure that everything, all the portals and everything are set. They've done the training. The beauty of Power School from a central office perspective is that our state reporting will be so much easier. And again, we will have these digital records that we don't have to keep, you know, the paper. You know, we will have the digital records. They're saved off-site. It's an exciting program. Coming from districts, I've been using PowerSchool for over 10 years. As I've also been using ASAP for quite a few years, my learning plan, all of these items that we are just now getting into. I think we're in our second year of ASAP.
Third. Second year. Or third?
My
third.
Learning plan.
Infinite Visions, which had a hiccup today, but you know, these are all programs I'm used to, and I highly recommend Power School, and I'm thrilled that we made the change. And it's hard to rip that Band-Aid off and to switch from something that you're so used to. Luckily, Power School, they continue to, you know, innovate and improve, and they are also, after a point, it becomes kind of intuitive once you know how to, you know, navigate the system. So there has been training. The administrative staff is 3 days. The teachers have had 3 days or a 3-hour training with Gradebook. School Messenger Service, which is part of the robocall. We can send emails to just the ninth grade parents or make phone calls to just a select group. It's exciting. The nurse program, the SNAP, and school messenger. And the next phase will be connecting our library system, our destiny, with syncing it with PowerSchool. It's wonderful, and I'm excited for us. I think that a lot of hard work went into making it happen, and I'm just very pleased with our IT department.
Yes. Who's the vendor on PowerSchool? Is it Microsoft or somebody like that?
It's PowerSchool LLC. It's a limited liability corporation.
Okay, so it's a separate distinct. Mm-hmm.
Did you have any other questions? Motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
Seconded.
All yays?
Yay.
Thank you so much.